Hello guys, I hope wherever you're watching us from, you're having a great time. This is AfriPost and welcome to today's video. Many times we've talked about the challenges that black people went through in the hands of their slave owners in the United States and all other parts of the world. But while the voices of blacks has really been up there are very few white people who have stood up and said that they are supporting blacks and they do not approve of the activities that the colonizers and slave owners did during the times that they had power. In this video today, I want us to listen to this fiery speecher who was speaking in front of a white audience. He was white and he was speaking to a white audience. And he spoke about the respect that black people need in the United States. Let's watch this, then react to it at the end.
Now let me say something right quick. I think back on the African American people in America. I think how that they were taken against their wills, put in the belly of ships, brought over here, beat, cussed. Many of them died in the guts of those ships, thrown overboard. They were pulled from families over there. You ain't never heard a gut-wrenching song. Do you hear a black person sing one of those old black Negro spirituals? Nobody knows. I can't sing it like that, see, because I hadn't experienced what they be. When you've experienced hell, it comes out of the voice. I say, when you experience hell, it comes out of the voice. If you're one of those people that you got problem with black people or whatever, you better shut your mouth, because they're God's people. You better hear what I'm saying to you. You better shut your white mouth. You better shut your white mouth. I'm not kidding you. I know some of you was raised in the Deep South and you was raised by prejudiced people and bigoted people. You better get that out of your system. You better get it out of your system. It'll cause you to suffer right along with those masters. It'll cause you to suffer right along with them. These are God's people. And I know that there's wicked in white races and wicked in black races and all that. I'm not justifying none of that stuff. I'm just saying God knows what happened to the black race. He knows how they wound up over here, and God is going to reimburse the black people for all their trouble and all their labor. You watch what I tell you. Watch what I tell you.
So here he is. We got these leaders. All these are kings. They want to expand their territory, and they take over these areas. And they came to the Caribbean, came to Central America, South America, North America. And, of course, they're looking for wealth in the land. They're looking for gold, looking for diamonds. You know, they were looking for oil at that time because oil was not important to them. Wealth was land, agriculture. Because why? They were an agricultural society. So those who had good land became powerful kings. So when they came to these areas, to the Caribbean and South America, Central America, and this area called America, they realized they had a lot of land, and they tried to domesticate the local natives to work for them under force of arm, of course, and the natives couldn't handle it. Some of them ran, some of them fought, became very difficult, and the Portuguese were the first ones to go to Africa, and they discovered more land, and then they found some strong people, they said. This is all in history. And they realized these people were stronger than the ones that were in the territory that they discovered. They could live longer, last longer. They were more sturdy. They could handle the sun. You know, the Indians, the Aztecs, and all these folks, they couldn't handle the weight of the pressure. And so they shipped these people over to work in the farms. They call them plantations. And they literally made them chattel animals. Just like an ox. You were here to work. And so the slave trade became a reality. It was all economics. No slave was ever bought from African continent because of love. It was all economics. And it hasn't changed much. Okay, so we have now this problem of this trade route taking place. And you may ask, why did all of these kingdoms do it? All of them did it. The French did it. The Spanish did it. The Portuguese did it. The British did it. They traded in people. And they chose Africans because they were more durable. They actually used to breed people because, you know, they were stronger. They'd breed. They would choose the strongest male and the strongest female and put them together and have sex to produce a stronger slave. That was the element of the day. And this is why we lost families, because they didn't care. You know, if your husband was strong and you was weak, they take your husband away from you. They find a woman who was strong, your husband's weak, take her, put them together. And so the destruction of the family component, even psychologically, was a reality because of economics. You know, to sell a strong slave made sense. You get more money for a stronger slave, whether it's a male or a female. So This was the concept. Now, the question I want to ask you is, how could humans do this to humans? That's the question I want to deal with. Because these were leaders doing this. Well, I got the answer for you. Because here's what the Greeks believed that the Romans adopted that became the foundation of leadership for the kingdoms of Europe that created our countries today. The philosophy of the Greeks. Number one, they believe that leadership is a product of natural endowment. Now, those of you who studied philosophy would have read some of Plato's writings and Socrates' perceptions of men. You'd have read Aristotle's concept of the value of human, and you would find that these principles are in their philosophies. They believe that person was earmarked to be a leader if they had certain natural endowments. That means if you didn't have these natural endowments, then you were born to be a slave. This is Greek thinking. Let me put it another way. Number two, they believe that leadership is a product of birth traits. You can study this on the internet. It's all there. The Greeks believe that if you had certain traits, you were automatically born to be the ruling class. And if you didn't have those traits, you were born to be the serving class. If you do some research, you'll discover that some of the traits are shocking. For example, the Greeks believe that if you had fair pigmentation, you were created to be a leader. Well, that rules me out. They also believe that if you had thin lips, this is written in their doctrine, then you were designed to be a leader. So that rules me out. Then they said, if you had pointed noses, the gods chose you to be a leader. Well, you know I'm out twice. Then they said, if your hair was blonde and your eyes were blue, you are definitely designed to be the leader. Have mercy on me. Okay, this is not funny though. Think about it. This is what they believed. So you can understand why, when they went to Africa, the conclusion was the gods have blessed us today. We've got enough labor created by the gods to run our empires. And so the people became fuel for their machinery of their industries of agriculture. Now, I want you to understand, this was the philosophy of their leadership. This is very important. In other words, treating you like a non-human was not a matter of conscience. It was natural. You don't have the traits. So you were born to serve me. You were created by the Creator to be second class, to be my slave. You can't argue this. God chose you to be my servant. So the concept was, let me go to the third one. This is very important. This is also written in the Greeks philosophy, is that leadership is the product of what? Providence, they said. Providence means the gods chose those who would be leaders, and the gods chose those who would be followers. So this is not a matter of who you think you are. It's a matter of what the gods chose you to be. Do you understand how deep this is? This is in the psyche of the post-European era, which is still not over. Let me explain how this works out practically. If you went to college, what's your name? Okay, John went to college and got a PhD in physics. I'm talking about nuclear physics. This guy is a brain, he's sharp. PhD in nuclear physics. The problem is, it doesn't matter. You are simply seen as a very smart slave. Because your pigmentation, your nose, your lips, your eyes, your hair is the problem. It doesn't matter. So they actually would tell their neighbor, I have a smart slave. In other words, educating you, you think changes you. It doesn't. It ain't the brain that makes you different. So the system, the culture, doesn't translate your PhD into being a superior human. It says you are simply a superior thinking slave. So it doesn't matter how much education you get. It doesn't matter how much accolades you put behind your name. It doesn't matter how much you achieve. In the Greek mind, in the Roman mind, which is the leadership that came over, you are still a slave by providence. Do you know that they actually created a theology for this? Because every ideology needs a theology to make it legal. Can I say it again? Yes. Write it down. Every ideology needs a theology to make it legal. So you will find, even like in apartheid, apartheid had a theology created by the Dutch Reformed Church, which was based on Greek philosophy as well. Because remember, South Africa was taken over by Romans, you know, Europeans. Hitler, if you already remember Hitler, Adolf Hitler was an interesting guy. Adolf Hitler said that he had a visitation from God. You ever read his Mein Kampf? He believed that God chose him to restore the Roman Empire. That's why he had a plan to take over Europe again. He says that he was chosen by God to establish what he called the Third Reich. the third reign of the Romans. And this is why, again, his concept of leadership, his philosophy, made it easy for him to destroy people. You know, remember, you need blonde hair, blue eyes, sharp nose. So when he looked at the Jews, for example, the Jews got dark hair, dark brown eyes or black eyes, olive skin. He said, they are rats to our society, he says. They are sucking our blood. We must kill them. Why? These are not real humans. The gods have made them to be our slaves. So here's my point. Where did you get your philosophy from determines how you lead people. The way you think about people determines how you lead them or destroy them.
Now, I like what the pastor says. He said that shut your white mouth, meaning that he's talking to a white audience and he wants them to really listen to what he's saying. He has identified the fact that blacks have been disenfranchised. They were taken through hard labor and they were persecuted, whipped and done to some of the most despicable things. He really hits the nail on the head and tells off white people who really think that they are more privileged or who really think that they should be getting more privilege than the blacks in United States. I think these are the kind of people that should be speaking to our societies, because if you look at the level of hatred that some whites still harbor in their hearts against black people, they really need sermons like this. Another preacher who also inspired me there is Pastor Jeremiah Wright. He speaks about the challenges that blacks in America have gone through. He speaks about why we should not say God bless America, but God damn America, because of the persecutions that America has subjected towards blacks and other minority ethnic groups. I don't know what you think about this, but for me, I think these pastors are really doing a great work, and we need to have more preachers like them, so that we get to have a better society as we could have it. Tell me your opinion down in the comment section. Also remember to subscribe to our channel if you're watching us for the first time. And please don't forget to give this video a thumbs up. Thank you, and may the good Lord bless you. Goodbye.